In this video, we're going to take a look at the review solutions for this test review for a rates of change test in considerable detail and go over the questions completely. And the first one asks, what is the average rate of change between where x equals 1 and x equals 3 for this function? And this is really a slope type calculation. The rate is really the slope between the two places in the function where x is 1 and x is 3. And so this is really the same as like y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. Same idea. So the y2 really refers to the function value at 3, and then the y1 is the function value at 1. So we get the function value at 3 by putting 3 into the function everywhere where you see x. So negative 2 times 3 squared minus 3 plus 5. So this is the f of 3 minus f of 1. F of 1 is in the square bracket. So if we put 1 in here, negative 2 times 1 squared minus 1 plus 5, that's the f of 1 in the brackets. And in the denominator, it's 3 minus 1 because the x coordinates are 3 and 1. So 3 minus 1, which simplifies to 2 here. And so let's expand and simplify all these parts. 3 squared is 9 times negative 2 is negative 18. And then we have minus 3 plus 5. I'll explain in a moment why that's crossed out. 1 squared is 1 times negative 2 would be, this is negative 2. And so when you take the brackets off, subtracting negative 2 is same as plus 2. Subtracting negative 1 is the same as adding 1. Subtracting 5 is, that's why that's a minus 5. The 5 and negative 5 are opposites, or 5 and negative 5 add to 0. So 5 minus 5 is 0. That's why I crossed those off. So it's really just negative 18 minus 3 plus 2 plus 1. And actually notice that 2 and 1 adds a 3, and that negative 3 would add to 0. So it's really just negative 18 on top over this 2, and that negative 18 divided by 2 is negative 9. So negative 9 is the slope of the secant line that connects the points where x is 1 and 3. That is the average rate of change between where x is 1 and 3. On to question number 2. What's the simplified average rate of change for function between where x is 5 and 5 plus h for this function? Well, again, this is really a slope calculation, but instead of saying like 5 and 6 or 1 and 3 like the last question, it says for 5 and 5 plus h. So h is this just the difference between these two x-coordinates. So for example, if h was 1, then this would go from 5 to 6, because if h is 1, 5 and 1 would add to 6. So h is just the horizontal distance between the two x-coordinates for the secant points. And so this is the function. So again, very similar to the first one, the rate is, and this is really a function value minus a function value, or y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. That's the difference between the two x coordinates. So f of 5 plus h, we put 5 plus h in place of x here. So 3 times 5 plus h squared minus 7 times 5 plus h. So this right here that I'm circling is the f of 5 plus h. For f of 5, we put 5 in here. So 3 times 5 squared, and then 5 in here, minus 7 times 5. So what's in the square brackets is the f of 5. Now, I need to, 5 plus h minus 5 simplifies to just h, because the 5 and minus 5 add to 0. And so we want to square this 5 plus h. And so that's what I've done up here. 5 plus h squared is a 5 plus h times another 5 plus h. And so 5 times 5 is the 25. 5 times the h is 5h, h times 5 is another 5h, and h times h gives you h squared. Now these two terms are like terms, so 5h and 5h add to 10h, and so it simplifies to 25 plus 10h plus h squared. So that's why that's in the brackets here now, that's the 5 plus h squared. And I started distributing in the negative 7 here, for example. Negative 7 times 5 is negative 35, and negative 7 times the h is minus 7h. In the round brackets, I changed actually the square brackets to round brackets here, because I only need one level of parentheses. 5 squared is 25, times 3 is 75. 7 times 5 is 35, so that's why that's a minus 35 now. So in the next step from here to here, I'm going to distribute this 3 in, and I'm going to take the brackets off here. So 3 times 25 is 75, and 3 times 10h would be 30h, and 3 times h squared would be 3h squared. And then minus 35 minus 7h, that's the same. And take the brackets off, this becomes minus 75, and this becomes plus 35. This minus 75 and plus 75 add to 0. That's why they're crossed out. And the minus 35 and the plus 35 also add to 0. So we're actually just left with three terms on top. So the 3h squared and 30h minus 7h would be 23h. So I'm just collecting like terms there. Now, those both terms have h's in them, so they divide evenly by this h here. So 3h squared divided by h would be 3h, and 23h divided by h would be 23. And so this is the average rate of change between the places where x is 5 and 5 plus h. Back to when I was talking about the 6, if I wanted the slope of the secant line for x is 5 to x is 6, then h would be 1. So I could just put 1 in here. 3 times 1 would be 3, plus 23 would be 26. So 26 would actually be the slope of the secant line that goes from the point where x is 5 and x is 6. If you want a different value, you could use a different h value. For question number 3, he asks, what is the graphical representation of the instantaneous rate of change? And so I have this blue curve here, kind of hand-drawn, so it's kind of iffy for a curve, but it's hand-drawn. The green line represents a secant because it goes between two different points in the curve. So if we want the average rate of change from there to there, then it's the slope of the secant line. If we want the instantaneous rate of change, that's the slope of the tangent line at a specific point on the curve. So the tangent line actually just touches the curve at that place right there. And so at that point, the instantaneous rate of change would be the slope of this tangent curve. I can approximate an instantaneous rate of change with a secant if I take the secant line and I move the points closer together. So notice I'm moving, as I move them close together, notice that the slope of the secant line, it's becoming more and more like the tangent line the closer I put them. So, for example, let's do this one more time. So those two points are fairly close together. And notice that the secant line looks, its slope is very similar to the tangent line slope. Almost disappears when I unhighlight it. So the graphical representation of the instantaneous rate of change is the slope of a tangent line at a specific point in the curve. For question number 4, we're given this function f of x equals negative 3 over x, and we're asked to calculate this, where a is negative 1, and then find what the rate is for two different h values. So f of a plus h minus f of a over h, and so here's my formula here. I'm going to put negative 1 in place of a here and here, so negative 1 plus h, and this would be f of negative 1. And so this is our function. So if I want to know what f of negative 1 plus h is, I'll put negative 1 plus h in place of x. So it'll be negative 3 over negative 1 plus h, which is what this is. And f of negative 1, I'll put negative 1 in there. So it would be negative 3 over negative 1. And so I'm going to simplify this a bit. There's an awful lot of negatives here, so let's simplify that a bit. So to do that, what you could do is multiply by negative 1 top and bottom. And so negative 1 times, and I use that negative with a 3, negative 1 times negative 3 is 3, and when you multiply the negative 1 plus h by negative 1, it just changes both signs. So that would become a positive 1, then this would be minus h. So it simplifies the 3 over 1 minus h. That's a little simpler version than what we had here at the beginning. And afterwards, there's three negatives here. Remember, when you multiply and divide negatives, an odd number of them gives you a negative. So this would simplify to just minus 3 over 1. So now, in order to be able to subtract these, I need a common denominator. So the denominators are 1 minus h and 1. So because this denominator is just 1, then the 1 minus h is the common denominator. So that's why this 3 gets multiplied top and bottom by 1 minus h. So the common denominator will be 1 minus h, so there's the common denominator. And so I have this 3, that's that 3 right there, and minus 3 times 1 minus h. Well, you can think that as a negative 3 that you're going to expand into the 1 minus h. So negative 3 times 1 is this minus 3, and negative 3 times negative h is plus h. And the reason those are crossed out is because 3 minus 3 is 0. So essentially there's just h from all of this over the 1 minus h denominator. Now, I'm kind of doing two things at once here. This h that was in the denominator was h is the same as h over 1. So what I'm actually doing is I'm taking that h over 1 minus h that I just simplified from here, and I'm multiplying it by the reciprocal of h over 1, which is 1 over h. And so after those 3's subtract to 0, this h, that's the only thing left in the numerator, will divide out with this h here. And so on top here, I would just have, there's really a 1 there, times 1 is 1, and 1 minus h times, there's really a 1 here, is 1 minus h. So that's the average rate of change between that x value and that x value. Or, actually more specifically, negative 1 plus h and negative 1. And so, this we're going to find the rate for two different h values. So I'm going to take my 1 over 1 minus h and I put 0.5 in place of h. So 1 minus 0.5 is 0.5, and 1 divided by 0.5 is 2. So that's the average rate of change. Now, specifically, this goes from negative 1 to negative 1 plus h. So if h was 0.5, it would actually go from negative 1 to negative a half, because you would have added 0.5 to that x-coordinate. So that's the slope of the tangent line from where x is negative 1 to negative 0.5. The second one, we're asked to use a 0.1 value. So we put 0.1 in place of h, 1 minus 0.1 is 0.9. And if you want to change this into a fraction with only decimals, just because there's one decimal place, multiply everything by 10. So just like that. So 1 times 10 is 10, 0.9 times 10 is 9, so we get 10 over 9, or 1.1 repeating. So that would be the average rate of change from where x equals negative 1, and if h is 0.1, if you add 0.1 to that, you would get the second, like the end of the secant point, would be negative 0.9. So that would be the average rate of change for between these two x-coordinates on the graph. In question number 5, if the population growth, and p is the population, in a community is projected to follow this function, where t is the time in years, we're asked to find the average rate of growth from the third to the fourth year. So again, this is a slope type calculation, just like the first several questions. So it's like y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. And so we would find the population in the fourth year and subtract from it the population in the third year. So that's a change in population in a year, because it goes from year 4 to year 3, or year 3 to year 4. So 4 minus 3 would be 1 in the denominator. So to find p of 4, we put 4 in here, so negative 4 times 4 squared plus 48 times 4 plus the 56, and then minus p of 3 is in the square brackets, so we put 3 here, negative 4 times 3 squared plus 48 times 3 plus the 56. And so 4 squared is 16 times negative 4 would be negative 64, 48 times 4 is 192 plus the 56, and 3 squared is 9. Times negative 4 would be negative 36, and when you take the brackets off, this changes it to a plus 36. 48 times 3 is 144, and again, this, when we take the brackets off, it changes it to minus 144, and then minus 56, again, from that negative sign. The 56s actually are opposites, so they could just be crossed out, because they add to 0, and so you have negative 64 plus 192 plus the 36 minus 144, and I'll just draw my calculator in for a moment here, and notice that does add to 20. So the rate would be, and the rate is actually, it's a rate of change, so you should put the proper units. P is population of people, and T is the time in years. So the rate, the population is changing at a rate of 20 people per year from the third to the fourth year. So make sure in a rate you always have the correct units. In question number 6, we're given the population model for a particular community as P of T is negative 4T squared plus 48T plus 56, and P is the number of people and T would be the time in years. And we're asked to find the instantaneous rate of growth in the third year. So not between like the third and the fourth year as in the last example, but what is the growth rate at this point in time? And so we would use this function Well, this is really a derivative calculation. P prime is what we're trying to find here at the third year, would equal the limit of P of A plus H minus P of A over H. Now, A here would be 3, so that's where we're going to put 3 in place of A, because it's the third year we're talking about. So P of 3 plus H minus P of 3 over H. And so if we want to find what P of 3 is, well, we put 3 in place of time here, or 3 plus H, sorry. We put 3 plus H in place of time. So we do negative 4 times 3 plus H squared, so that's this. And we put 3 plus H here, so 48 plus 48 times 3 plus H plus 56. So this right here that I'm circling is the P of 3 plus H. P of 3 is when you put just 3 in place of T. And so that's what's in the square brackets here. So negative 4 times 3 squared plus 48 times 3, plus the 56. And so we'll start expanding this and then simplify. So the 3 plus h squared, 3 plus h squared works out to 9 plus 6h plus h squared. And so there's the calculation. And so this negative 4 is going to be multiplied by that because that's the 3 plus h squared. So negative 4 times 9 is minus 36, negative 4 times 6h is minus 24h, and negative 4 times the h squared is minus 4h squared. We distribute the 48 in. 48 times 3 is 144. 48 times h would be 48h, and then plus the 56. 3 squared is 9 times negative 4 would be minus 36. 48 times 3 is 144, just like it was over here, right there. And we have the plus 56. So on the next line, I'm going to take the brackets off here. And so that negative in front will change every sign here. So it'll be plus 36, minus 144, minus 56. And there's a whole bunch of stuff canceled or crossed out here because there's a lot of opposites that add to 0. So for example, this negative 36 and this plus 36 add to 0. The 144 and negative 144 add to 0. And the 56 and minus 56 add to 0. And so we only actually had 3 terms left here. There's this negative 4h squared. And then there's 2 h terms. 48h minus 24h is 24h. And so they both divide evenly because they both are h terms, or h and h squared. They divide evenly by this h. So h goes into that, leaving a negative 4h, and 24h divided by h is 24. And so to get the derivative, we take the limit of this as h tends towards 0. Well, if h tends towards 0, the negative 4 times a number really, really close to 0 would tend towards 0, and so then the derivative is just 24. And so the population is changing at a rate of about 24 people per year in the third year. In question number 7, we're asked to show a numerical method of approximating the instantaneous rate of change at 4 for this function. And it says using secants. So this is still a slope type calculation, but to approximate the instantaneous rate, you want these two values to be quite close together. That's why it says with two different h values. That's the hint here. And so if you take, so it's supposed to be a 4, so 4 and like 3.9, those x coordinates are quite close together. So we find f of 4 by putting 4 in place of x here. And so 2 times 4 squared, and 4 in there, minus 9 times 4, plus 4, lots of 4s here, minus, and f of 3.9 is what's in the square bracket. So we're putting 3.9 here and here, so that's what we get. And so 4 squared is 16 times 2 is 32, and 9 times 4 is 36, so minus 36 there, plus the 4. 3.9 squared times 2 is 30.42, and negative 9 times 3.9 is minus 35.1, plus the 4. Take the brackets off. Remember, this will change all the signs. So this will be plus, and then that will be minus. The 4 and negative 4 add to 0. And so if we do 32 minus 36 minus 30.42, plus 35.1, we get 0.68. And just to demonstrate that that was calculated correctly, there's the same number subtract and add, so we do get 0.68. We'll move that over here. And the actually, I didn't mention this all along, I suppose I should have. 4 minus 3.9 is 0.1, so that's why we're dividing by 0.1 all the way down here. 0.68 divided by 0.1 is 6.8, so that's the approximation for the instantaneous rate of change. Now, for the second one, I'm going to choose like a smaller h value, a smaller difference between the two x-coordinates. So here I use 0.1, here I'm going to use 0.01. So 4 and 4 and 3.99. So very similar calculation. Of course, the first part's all the same. This is all the same, just like this is here. The only difference is what's in the brackets here. So instead of 3.9, it's 3.99. And so if we evaluate all this, and of course, remember when you take the brackets off, the signs change. In the denominator, 4 minus 3.99 is 0.01 all the way down. And then this all, and maybe I'll do that as well here. And so there's the calculation that's done up here. I didn't bother include the 4 and negative 4 because they add to 0 anyway. So we get 0.0698, and we're dividing it by 0.01. And so we do get 6.98. So those, it seems to be getting close to 7. Okay, so a really good educated guess for the instantaneous rate of change at 4 would be about 7. That's getting pretty close to 7. In question number 8, you're asked to show two graphical approximations of an instantaneous rate of change at 2, where x is 2. And so where x is 2 on this red curve is right here. So what you're doing is you're drawing tangent lines and just calculating their slopes. So this first one, and maybe I'll... I guess I can't move it out of the way. It's right. I didn't draw it in here. For this one here... that's my one tangent that comes down to here. And so the slope, I'm actually just counting here. So the rise is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 on top. And the run across the bottom is 3. And so that slope of this one here is about 2. Now I draw a slightly different tangent line, a longer one. And so if I count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, that's the rise. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or pretty close to 5 is the run. So 8 divided by 5, 1.6. So it's between 1.5 and 2. So that's how you can approximate graphically an instantaneous rate of change. In question number 9, you're asked, what is the average rate of change between x and x plus h for this function? And you're asked to show how it simplifies. And so the average rate, we're not into instantaneous here, just average rates, would be f of x plus h minus f of x over h. And so we will put x plus h in place of x here and here. So 5 times x plus h minus 4 on top, and x plus h in the denominator. And f of x, well, this is the f of x function, so it's minus the 5x minus 4 over x. Now, in order to actually subtract these, and it's, of course, is over h still, we need a common denominator. So, all I'm going to do is I'm expanding this 5 out, and I'll get the common denominator in a moment. 5 times x is 5x, and 5 times h is 5h. So, the denominators are x and x plus h, so I would multiply this one by x plus h top and bottom, which is what I'm doing here, and I multiply this one by the x top and bottom, and that's what I'm doing right here. And so, if I expand this x in, and the common denominator is, look right here, is x times x plus h. That's why it's x times x plus h in the next line. And so on top, the x gets expanded in. So x times 5x is 5x squared. X times the 5h is 5xh or 5hx. Minus 4 times x is minus 4x. And then over here, we've got to multiply 5x minus 4 by x plus h. And maybe I'll take a moment and pause and do that. Okay, so that's the calculation. We're multiplying 5x minus 4 by x plus h. So 5x times x would be 5x squared. 5x times h would be plus 5xh. Negative 4 times x would be minus 4x. And negative 4 times h would be minus 4h. Now, there is a subtraction sign before that multiplication. So that will change every sign here. So the 5x squared was positive, so that's why it's minus 5x squared. The 5xh was positive, that's why it's minus here. And both of these are negative in the multiplication, so that's why they end up being both plus here. So notice there's lots of opposites here that add to zero. I've actually duplicated this in the next line. We'll move it up a little bit here. And so this 5x squared and this minus 5x squared add to zero. This 5xh and the minus 5xh add to 0. The negative 4x and the 4x add to 0. So the only thing left here actually is the 4h. And so we have 4h over x times x plus h, that's this, over the h in the denominator. And so what I'm going to do is that h is really the same as h over 1. And so I'm going to take the rational expression in the numerator, 4h over x, x plus h, and multiply it by the reciprocal of h over 1, which is 1 over h. And the h's divide out. So in the numerator, 4 times 1 is 4, and then in the denominator we get x times x plus h. So that's the average rate of change, and that's what we're asked up here, between x and x plus h for this function. So that's what it simplifies to. Now, if you had a specific h value, you could actually calculate the average rate of change, and if you had a particular x value, you could actually get a numerical calculation. In question number 10 here, we're given the first principles definition of the derivative and a couple of functions and asked to find the derivative of them using that formula. And so the first one is f of x equals negative 4x squared. And so here's the first principles definition of the derivative. Now to find f of x plus h, we would put x plus h in place of x here. So we go negative 4 times x plus h squared. And minus f of x, well, this is f of x, so minus the negative 4x squared. And so in order to square the x plus h, that's what this is showing here. So if we multiply x plus h by another x plus h, you get x squared plus 2xh plus h squared. Now, that's what's in here. All this gets multiplied by negative 4. So negative 4 times x squared is minus 4x squared. Negative 4 times the 2xh is minus 8xh. And negative 4 times the h squared would be minus 4h squared. And this double negative here, this ends up being a plus 4x squared. The negative 4x squared and 4x squared, this is really just another copy of the same thing here, they're opposites, so they add to 0. And so we just really just have these two terms, and they divide evenly by the h, so that h divides out. Negative 8xh divided by h is negative 8x, and negative 4h squared divided by h is minus 4h. Now as h tends towards 0, negative 4 times a number that's really close to 0 would be get really close to 0. And so essentially this becomes just negative 8x. So negative 8x is the derivative of negative 4x squared. For b here, our function is g of x equals 5 over 4x. And notice it's called g of x. So instead of f of x plus h and f of x and f prime, it'd be g prime equals the limit as h tends towards 0 of g of x plus h minus g of x over h. So if there's a different name on your function, make sure you use that name in your work here. So g of x plus h, so we put x plus h in place of x here. So it'd be 5 over 4 times x plus h, that's this, that's the g of x plus h, minus g of x, well this is g of x here, so that's the 5 over 4x. And so what I've done is I've put a copy of them down here, I'm getting the common denominator. Now, so these are the two denominators. Notice there's already a 4 in each one, so we don't need to multiply by 4, but this one doesn't have a factor of x, so that's why I multiply top and bottom by x. And this one has the 4 and the x, but not the x plus h. So we need to multiply by x plus h top and bottom. So the common denominator will be 4x times x plus h, which is what's written right here. So on top here, 5 times x is this 5x. And then it's really minus 5 times this. Some people might actually put brackets around this. And so negative 5 times x is minus 5x, and negative 5 times the h is minus 5h over our common denominator. Now I've put another copy of this down here just to illustrate that the 5x minus 5x, they add to 0. And so there's really just negative 5h over the denominator over h. And so remember, this h in the denominator is really over 1. I've done that a few times in this. And so we're going to take this rational expression, the negative 5 over 4x, x plus h, which is right here, and multiply it by the reciprocal of h, which would be 1 over h. And so we'll go down a little further. When you do that, this h and this h divide out. And so negative 5 times 1 is negative 5. And in the denominator, we have 4x times x plus h times a 1 over here, I suppose, so it's still 4x, x plus h. And To get the derivative, we take the limit as h tends towards 0. So if h tends towards 0, then this is basically x plus a number really close to 0. So this is basically just x. So x times the 4x is 4x squared. And so the derivative of g is negative 5 over 4x squared. And that's the end of the video.